What's up?
Aaron from 2001. You are here before the go live notification. Congratulations. You finally caught a stream? Yeah, I haven't even actually started stream yet. Twitch does this lovely thing where it won't start stream right away. So it doesn't send the go live notification to everyone right away. You have to wait a sec to get the go live notification to go out, which means that you were here before that, which means that you were going to be the only one here for a sec. Oh, and there you go. Bingo bongo. Wait for everyone to come in. And action. Yo. What's up? Yo. I'm good. How are you, Blurry? You know what's crazy, Blurry? You're like big dog in the Discord server now. But I remember just like seeing Blurry Cowboy in chat. Just like a random person that I saw once or twice recognize the name Blurry Cowboy. Now you're the big man. What's up, Hypey? Interesting opinion you've got there. You were just watching my new video? Yeah, that's the beauty. That's how this works. So like, I try to do this, but I'm never free. I've never been able to do it before, but I've heard from other people who have like YouTube and Twitch that if you go live like 5 minutes after you post a YouTube video, more people are likely to come over from the YouTube video, assuming the YouTube video does well, more people are likely to come over from the YouTube video and see that you're live. And then you've got opportunity to appeal to a new audience, which is pretty cool. How many people is this your first stream? What's up? All the homies still call me a new head? You absolutely are a new head, Blurry. Hate to tell you, but you are a fat new head, Blurry. Old heads are over a year ago. Mid heads are like a year Tiger. To 6 months.
Happy 6 months, streamer boy, less aww, than three. Aw, thank you so.
6 months, goddamn. That's crazy. 6 months sub, Soph. And you subbed because you wanted to vote on the fate of T-Mob. And look where we are now. My day's been good, Bunny Emperor. Sick name you've got there. Bunny Emperor 20. I got the note from both the stream and the video and had to choose. Okay, well that's not the intended effect. The intended effect is you watch the video and as you're watching the video, you come to the stream. Or maybe vice versa, you're watching the stream, you go to the video after. Basically to keep you interested, but that works too, I guess. Do you have an aquarium? I do at home. What's up, Whirly? Nope, not doing a crustaceans video. I don't know anything about crustaceans. I would not be able to provide anything useful as a crustacean video. The Crabzilla thing happened by accident. The whole, like, me having Crabzilla be a meme on my channel was a complete accident. The effect works on me. Let's go. Need some info for a school project? I would look online. I mean, if you're trying to get in contact with me, DMing me on Twitter is the best way. I read all of my Twitter DMs, but I don't respond to all of them because I get like 10 a day and most of them are just stuff that you could Google. Thank you, Soph. Zach, I like your beard today. Thanks, Whirly. It's starting to come in like more together. I like the way my beard works is it's very sparse at first and then it like comes in a little bit more. So today, I guess, just a good day for it being full. Do I know anything about pet red-eared slider turtles? I don't, other than what they look like, and I've seen lots of people have them. It's getting better and better. It's usually how it works, but then it'll reach a point where, see, my beard doesn't fill in, so, like, notice how it doesn't connect here? I will never get that connection. The hair just does not go there, right? So it's gonna reach a point where it's just fucking branching out. Thank you, Razor Blue. It's gonna reach a point where it's just fucking, like, Amish beard type shit, and then it doesn't look good. On me, at least. So, yeah, I'm not getting chops. I'm not... I'll be honest, Jay Schlatt might be the only man on Earth who can pull off the fucking sideburns like that. Just overgrown sideburns and nothing else. I'll probably just try and keep it around this length. We'll see how it looks when I haven't grown it out this much in a while. So I don't know. Last time I tried to grow it out this much was probably about a year ago. You could look at some of my old... Here, wait. Let me find an old YouTube video of mine. I'll show you guys. Dude, in some of my old videos, here, let me do the one with H2A, I specifically remember. This was like, I hadn't shaved in a really long time. Honestly? It's probably about where it is now. I think maybe it was a little more grown then. Well, yeah. It might have been a little more grown then, but, like, about the same thing. That was over a year ago, I think. Like, right about over a year ago. 12, 13 months ago. Got the e-boy hair in full phase. Me or H-Twa? H-Twa is an e-boy. H-Twa is an e... E-they. Can you be an e-boy if you're a they-them? An e-they? Doesn't have the same ring as e-girl or e-boy. E-non-binary. Doesn't ring as well. not as appealing. Slat is the only man who can pull off mutton chops. I agree. E-N-B. E-N-by. E-kid. What is E-flaccid? What does that even mean? Mutton chops are hot. I think you might be one of the only people with that opinion. No, yeah, there's not gonna get 700 viewers. Not unless I do a YouTube stream again. My YouTube stream had like 1,000 viewers. I could probably do, and I have double the subs now. I could probably do a YouTube stream and get 700 viewers. But on Twitch, no, not gonna get 700 viewers. Not likely, at least. You know what I'm fucked up about? So I have a GameCube controller, because I play Melee, then I use it for Mario and stuff, and I brought it with me in my my bag to play Melee at like a club meeting, and at some point along the way, you can't see it, but it's cracked. The Z button is cracked right down the middle there. So some point along the way, the button cracked, and now it's like not usable. So I'm considering... my house has GameCube controllers. They're like knockoff GameCube controllers, but I'm considering just like taking one of those and just yoinking the Z button and then giving them my broken one, because they're playing Ultimate on a like on a television. So they're playing like full 1 second delay Ultimate. I think they're not going to miss a single Z button. I also want to fix all the house controllers. That's something I want to do. I have like my Tri-Wings for repairing. I'm like taking apart GameCube controllers. You own any pet fish? Indeed I do. Not with me right now. Not here. Caleb Shaw. That name sounds familiar for some reason. What's up? Are a jellyfish of your choice or a crab of your choice? Can I count non-jelly jellies, like stenophores? Because I love comb jellies. They're not jellyfish. They're stenophores, but... or tenophores. Good morning, aquatic veterans of New Jackson. Dude, when Marge said aquatic... She said that on Twitter. I said, good morning, like, Margarine... Or I said, thank you, Margarine. She said, thank you, aquatic veterans of New Jersey. And I put aquatic veterans be like... It's like a fucking Navy SEAL dude. It's aquatic veterinarians, bro. A fish biologist owns fish? Pog. If you could save any species of fish from extinction, what would it be? Desert pupfish. They're not extinct, but they're working on it. It's just such a cool endemic species. I love desert pupfish. I might do a presentation on desert pupfish at some point. I love like the idea of like the variation in the pools and everything with them. When is the next Invent-A-Fish gonna be? I don't know. Probably not for another month at least. Maybe November sometime. Okay, it's a crazy Twitch message there. Is that Russian band poster behind you? Yeah, it's Kino. It says Soyuziv. Victor Soy lives! What the fuck was that Among Us message? Couldn't tell you. I've got a decent delay, so I'm like, sorry if I'm not responding to you guys instantly. For some reason, it's a little delayed today. All right, shall we present? I don't have a ton of, well, I probably have plenty of time. I have an interesting lineup of React videos, but I also have a fire presentation today. Someone is outside my window. What did I do? Walking around out there. Escaped. Show controls. How do you do this? View present. Yeah. How many times have I done this? No, don't worry. It's fine, guys. I should probably close the window, but I'm over it. It's nice out. Sex first stalker? Not my first. Did I tell you guys about that one girl? Girl who, like, decided to question my credentials, which is like, okay, fine, if you don't want to, like, check whether I'm a fish biologist or not, and you, like, want to, like, whatever. So she was like, I looked into it, and I don't think that you are qualified as a fish biologist. I was like, okay, that's cool. I mean, I am, but sure, whatever you want. And then, she was like, she like listed out like a like multiple paragraphs of like why she thinks that I'm not qualified, and it was a bunch of really stupid reasons, but that's not the point. And then I didn't respond for like a day because I was like, this is such a stupid response. This is such a stupid thing.
I'm goated.
Thanks, Oval. This is such a stupid thing. And then she does like deep online research on me to find professors that I work with and do research with, and personally emails them to tell them that they need to tell me that I am not a fish biologist. And the greatest part of that is my professor who I work with like, you know, fishery science, ichthyology stuff, emailed her back and basically said, shut the fuck up. And it's so funny to me. He's like a 60-year-old just bald dude with a goatee, and he basically emailed this poor college girl who was stalking me, shut the fuck up. Classic. But yeah, I wouldn't call that a stalker, but I responded very negatively, obviously, because she was like, I've taken the liberty to reach out to your professors. And I said, bitch, what? I said, that is fucking creepy. That is harassment. I need you to stop contacting me at once and leave me the fuck alone. So I wouldn't call it a full-on stalker, but moral of the story is close enough. Amazing professor? Yeah, he's fucking awesome. I love that guy. I love that. That's so funny to me. She never told me what he responded, but then I have a class with him this semester, so like I came, and that was over the summer, so I came in this semester, and like he was like, yeah, I got this strange email about you, and I was like racking my, I'm like, what are you talking? Oh, I was like, oh my god, that fucking girl on Twitter, and who's like questioning my credibility. He's like, yeah, I basically told her to fuck off. It was so funny. We were just like eating lunch at class. All right, shall we? Fuck, I was supposed to be, okay, so many people have commented about this. I was supposed to be more conscientious of where my camera is, because I feel like I always put text or an image or something in the bottom left, and then I'm like, hey guys, look at this image in the bottom left, and I'm just covering it. But, well, I didn't think about it when I made this presentation, so I'm sorry if I cover anything up with my face. I'll try my best. I guess switch it to another display. Just move your cam. Yeah, but then I have to move the nice little background. Don't you see? It's not just the camera. There's a little gray border around it that makes it look all nice. A little transparent border. So much work. I guess I could do it. Guess I could do it if I need to. You can move multiple things at a time. I know you can shift click. I'm just lazy. Zach, is this topic going to have a YouTube video? Yes. I've never once done a presentation that didn't have a YouTube video. The only thing that doesn't go on YouTube is when I play Mario. Everything else I do on stream is for YouTube content. Yeah, I'm gonna do that, Worley. I mean, I think I have one, right? Is that what this scene is? Yeah, look at that. Now I'm on the right side. Cool. So I can just switch between those two, even though that one's not exactly right. It's close enough. All right. Fuck, whatever, Whirly. I'll fix it if it comes to it. Maybe I won't block anything. Maybe I'll get lucky. Maybe it'll be perfect today. Okay, so the question we are going to talk about today is whether fish feel pain. And this is probably the most controversial thing I've talked about. Not that like the conclusions on it are exactly controversial, but people's opinions, if you want to call it that, are extremely controversial, because a lot of like fishing, commercial fishing, you know, how they kill fish on the boats for commercial fishing, and most importantly recreational fishing, is done in what you would call inhumane ways, right? Putting a hook through the mouth of something that feels pain, yanking it out of the water so it's suffocating, you know, showing it off and all that, and then throwing it back in, is like, if you believe that fish feel pain, that's a very fucked up thing to do. I mean, like, imagine putting a hook through your dog's mouth or your cat's mouth and dragging it, you know, into the water or something like that. So it's like a very, very, like, just distinctly negative thing that people don't like to think about. So it's not exactly that science is inconclusive or that like we don't know whether fish feel pain or that. It's just that there's a lot of people who deny it, because if they were to accept that fish do in fact feel pain, they would be accepting that recreational fishing is causing animal suffering. And that's a hard thing for a lot of people to get over, especially a lot of people who are into fish, like to fish because they get to see them. So me personally, I don't fish. I don't hook and line fish. I've done net fishing before, like trawling and stuff like that, for like sampling. But I personally don't, but I also don't judge other people, because I think you have the right to do what you would like. But I think that in general, I think that it's a weird line. And a lot of the people who are denying fish pain in a non-scientific way are just doing it because they don't want to feel guilty. Okay. So the first thing we have to talk about, I forgot a slide. Anyways, this is a big thing in like news, and there's a lot of articles that go both ways. Mostly what you'll see is like studies that'll be like fish feel pain, or a study that's like fish do not feel pain, or this is my favorite title from the Smithsonian Magazine, it's official, fish feel pain. It's not official. And what does that even mean? We haven't even really defined what pain means yet. But I think it's really funny, because if you Google it, you'll get a variety of like conflicting answers, because everyone and their mom has some opinion that's not really scientific based. And there's a lot of like ways you can look at and assess pain, because you can never really guess no for sure totally. So there's a lot of different ways you can look at it, and people tend to have really unproductive ways of looking at it and comparing it. So the first thing to talk about is what we mean by pain, because this is like very important, because I say pain a lot, but you have to think of the correct thing. So there's physical pain, which is the response to or awareness of damage to tissue or other body parts. And this is basically provably present in almost all living organisms, because you need to avoid damaging your tissues to survive. And it's totally unconscious, okay? Think of like a person when they burn their hand on the stove, okay? Just the immediate reaction. You put your hand on the stove, it's too hot, your body pulls it away without you thinking. That is physical pain, okay? That's just that initial reaction, that jerk reaction. Almost all organisms have this. If you stab a fish, it's gonna fucking move out of the way because the fish doesn't want to be stabbed. It doesn't want damage to its tissues. This is not what we mean by pain. This is just nerve response. This is just awareness of tissue damage, okay? When we talk about pain, what we mean is emotional pain. This is suffering. It's stress response, it's avoidance behaviors, and it's lethargy and resuming normal behaviors. Basically, suffering, the thing that people debate about, right? No one's debating, no one reasonable at least, is debating that fish don't feel physical pain. That doesn't make any sense. But emotional pain and the concept of suffering is the important thing, right? So when you burn your hand on the stove, you don't just pull your hand away and then nothing happens, okay? You might pull your hand away and nothing happens immediately, okay? And that's the physical pain response. That's your body's natural reflex response. But then your hand starts fucking hurting and your hand burns and it might last like that for a while and you might have to fix everything and you're gonna be like in pain and suffering from it. Even if it's not severe, it's still suffering. Suffering is like an overused word to where we make it seem like it's just like, ah, extreme pain. Suffering just means like a lasting pain, a lasting emotional effect, right? So in response to that initial nerve pull away, the physical pain, humans, you will have an emotional pain. If I punch this like cement wall as hard as I can right now, my hand's gonna pull away and be like, fuck, and that's the physical pain. And then I'm gonna be like, fuck, my hand hurts, and it's gonna hurt for a while. And that's the emotional pain. And that's what we debate, is whether fish feel or not, because that is what constitutes suffering, because physical pain isn't really a big deal. If you don't feel emotional pain, and so like you can just be stabbed and you'll be like, oh man, I don't want to get stabbed, let me get out of here, but you're not actually suffering, then there's not much of like a moral responsibility. And that's what a lot of fishermen want to believe, especially recreational fishermen want to believe, is that they only experience physical pain. So it's like, yeah, they have a hook in their mouth, they don't want a hook in their mouth, but they're not suffering. Okay, so let's look at the evidence. First thing to note is, can we 100% know? I want to make this very clear. You cannot 100% know the experience of other organisms. If you are not that organism, you cannot know it. But we can use pretty clear comparisons to ourselves and then other vocal animals. So like dogs and cats, things that make noises when they're suffering, we can know, right? Like we might not be able to like live their experience, or we might not be able to exactly tell them or to have them tell us, but they're vocalizing animals. They can, you know, make a very clear sound, an explanation when they're in pain. Fish are not so capable of that. So we have to sort of compare them to the vocal animals, to ourselves, to dogs, to cats, and we can come to a pretty strong conclusion when we look at that. Okay, so the first thing is how to not compare pain, because this is how for a long time people compared pain, and this is why there's a myth, a long existing myth, that fish don't feel pain, and this is why so many people are willing to stick to that, because people compared pain solely by looking at structures and assuming that structures have to be the same. Okay, assuming that structures have to be the same. I know I'm covering this, I'll fix it. Assuming the structures have to be the same for things to function the same, which is not true. You do not need the brain of a human to have an experience that a human has, okay? You do not need the exact lobes of a human brain to know the exact experiences that a human has, okay? They're separate functions. And then there's this thing, which I will uncover up now, called analogous structures. And analogous structures basically means things that evolved somewhere along that are not related to each other but serve the same purpose, like wings and butterflies, wings and birds, okay? They didn't evolve from the same thing. Butterflies and birds are not closely related, but they serve the same purpose, okay? So a fish brain and a human brain can have differing structures that both serve to cause emotional suffering, emotional pain, right? So you can't just look at the structure and be like, nope, they don't have the center where we feel pain. So therefore, like, we've identified the center of a human brain as the part that feels pain, and since they don't have that, that must mean that they don't. That's a stupid way to go about it, and that's the way that it was gone about for centuries, and that's why this whole myth exists. Okay? How we actually compare pain, the correct way, response, function, not structure. Structure is a terrible way to compare because you have analogous structures. So this is a quote. Fish produce the same opiates, the body's innate painkillers that mammals do. So they're producing painkillers, which would be a weird thing to do if you're not feeling pain, long-lasting pain. If you're just having nerve response, why would your body produce painkillers? Their brain activity is analogous to that of terrestrial vertebrates. Sticking a pin into a goldfish or rainbow trout just behind their gills stimulates nociceptors, which are what we consider the pain receptors in fish, and a cascade of electrical activity that surges toward brain regions essential for conscious sensory perceptions, okay? So not just the hindbrain and brainstem, which is where nerves things happen. So if you were just having like a pull away response, like if a fish was just having a pull away response, you would expect the signals to only go to the hindbrain and the brainstem because that's where reflexes and impulses come from. But when fish feel pain, signals actually also go to the areas that have conscious thinking sensory perceptions, those parts of the fish brain. So why would the fish's body need painkillers? And why would the fish's body need a conscious awareness rather than just a reflex? Okay? Those are things that point pretty heavily towards the existence of suffering. So we're gonna look at some experiments. I didn't write anything down about these. I just put two pictures. So if I forget for a second, I might have to think a second. The first one is Lego block and acetic acid. This one I think is the weakest of the experiments, but I think it's interesting. Basically, fish show very avoidant behaviors when it comes to foreign objects, most fish at least. So if you have a tank full of rainbow trout, as you know, they did in this experiment, and you put in something large and brightly colored, like a big, brightly colored Lego brick, the fish are gonna avoid it. They're just gonna like not approach it, watch it from a distance, not go to that section of the tank, okay? Because that's just how fish are. They're very cautious with foreign objects, okay? However, when you inject the rainbow trout in this experiment with acetic acid, and acetic acid basically simulates nerve damage. So acetic acid, kind of like, imagine it like spice on your tongue, right? Like when you eat something spicy, it's like a pain. It's not actually nerve damage, but it like simulates that pain. And that's, humans like a little bit of that, and that's what we do with that. Acetic acid, basically if you inject it into the fish, it's simulating nerve damage. Like their body is feeling nerve damage, right? Like we feel spice on the tongue. So their body reacts in the normal way that they would if they were injured. So basically it's a way to make the fish's body think that they're injured without actually being injured. And if you inject fish with acetic acid, they no longer avoid the foreign object. And the conclusion from this is that they're too distracted by the suffering to care about the foreign object in the tank. Basically, if it was just a nerve response, then there would be no reason for their behavior to change. But their behavior does change. They no longer avoid the giant, brightly colored Lego brick in the tank once they have that, you know, tissue damage. Another one is the acetic acid versus benign saline. Oh, God. Oh, this is an eating one. Okay. This is resuming normal activity. So if you remember when I talked about emotional suffering, one of the things I said is lethargy with getting back to normal behaviors. So basically fish are injected, like a control group and experiment group are injected, one with acetic acid, you know, the simulate nerve damage, and one with benign saline, which does absolutely nothing. They injected both just so that there's no difference, you know, the other fish, even the ones being injected with saline, are still going through that stressful experience of being injected. You know, they have to be held for a second, they have to be injected. So they're still going through that negative experience, but they're not actually having any tissue damage. And it took the fish that were injected with acetic acid twice as long to resume normal feeding as it did the ones with benign saline, which basically means that it just doesn't make sense if it's only a nerve response. If it's only a quick like nerve response, like, oh, tissue damage, move out of the way, be done with it, why would it take you longer to resume normal activity? Why would your stress response be changed? Why would your behavior change? And then I think potentially the strongest one is painkillers and zebrafish. And now that I put this image on screen, I was just putting together images. I realize how funny this looks. Basically, we drugged zebrafish. Damn. What's up, Nirnim? Thank you. Basically, we drugged zebrafish. So if you have two tanks, as they did in this experiment, and you have an empty tank and a tank that is filled with plants and decorations and logs and gravel and places to hide, fish will almost always choose the planted tank given a choice. So basically, the fish in this experiment are given a choice between two tanks. They can choose the completely barren, empty tank, just water and nothing else in it, or they can choose the tank that's well planted. And if any of you guys have fish, you know they like plants, they like, you know, logs, they like things to hide in, okay? So given the choice, without any other outside factors, the zebrafish will always go for, almost always, I should say, their divergence, will almost always go for the planted tank, okay? However, if you inject the fish with acetic acid, okay, basically cause that, simulate that nerve damage, and then put in the barren tank painkillers, okay? So basically the barren tank is filled with an anesthetic, okay, that numbs pain, the fish will choose the empty tank. Will begin choosing the empty tank. So basically the idea is when they have no tissue damage, okay, no pain being simulated. Damn, Nirnim. Thank you. When the fish have no nerve damage being simulated, no tissue damage being simulated, they'll always choose the more appealing tank. However, the empty tank becomes more appealing if the fish is suffering and if it has painkillers. Why would a fish be attracted to painkillers? Who knows? There's other explanations for this. Maybe there's something else about the anesthetic that is appealing to the fish. It doesn't necessarily mean they're trying to numb the pain. However, it does seem to be a pretty strong tendency, and when you combine it with the other studies, you know. So the conclusion of this all is that most, not all, there are still some naysayers, but most of the scientific community at this point in time agrees that fish very likely, you know, experience emotional suffering. So what do we do now? Because fish are the most mistreated vertebrates by far, because they've always been viewed as simple and stupid. So how we harvested them, how we treated them in aquariums has never actually been thought about. You know, we shock fish to, and other kinds of, you know, nasty things to catch them for the aquarium trade. Most fish caught in commercial fishing are just thrown onto the boat from the nets and then just left there to suffocate. Because this is just, we viewed them as simple and stupid, and this is not something that we've ever taken the time to care about. However, now that, you know, more research is coming out, thank you, Nirnim. You know, things are changing. In first world aquaculture facilities, we're actually starting to use humane methods. Right, so the place that I work at right now, that I worked with, basically was building aquaculture systems in churches and food banks and things like that to provide more food, aquaponic systems, I should say. And when it came to killing the fish, we used strong electric currents because that is a humane way. It knocks them out completely, basically puts them, renders them unconscious with no, you know, no active feeling, and then you can kill them from there, and you don't have to worry about pain or writhing or anything like that, or missing, you know. So there's still lots of progress to be made, but there are places, particularly, you know, nonprofits and government agencies, you know, government aquaculture systems that are working towards having a more morally ethical environment for killing fish. So hopefully we see that continue. Just another reason to hate commercial fishing, though. Fuck commercial fishing. So bad for the environment, so bad for fish populations, so poorly regulated, and now you can add fish suffering onto it. Don't eat wild fish, eat farmed fish. All right. How was that presentation? What are our thoughts? Thank you, Whirly. Oh, I assume my comment section will be filled with people like, well, actually, saying some shit about their opinions, but whatever. Honestly, the controversy probably is, maybe it's helpful. Get more people commenting, boost the algorithm, more people watching, send it to their friends because they're enraged. Let's get it on Facebook. Okay. All right, guys. When this video comes out, I want you guys to all, right now, infiltrate a Facebook group. Wait, is this illegal? Infiltrate a fishing Facebook group, like a recreational Facebook group for recreational fishing. Just like join a random one, you know? hang out, act normal. Then when this video comes out, send the video in the group. I mean, I feel like even if fish do feel pain and they still kill them, yeah, it's not the problem. Killing is not the problem, the inhumane ways in which they're killed. Even cows, the ones like raised for meat, which are kept in cages their whole life, injected with all sorts of chemicals, even they get like a nail through the head, through the brain, so that they die instantly. Even they don't necessarily feel pain on the way out. So it's just about having a more humane method of doing things than, you know, leaving them on the deck to suffocate. That's all. Joining fishing Facebook groups as we speak? Perfect. And when this video comes out, you guys know what to do. Let's cause controversy. Let's cause rage. What's up, Zarelin? Is this considered a mob mentality? Have I just created a mob? That's gotta be illegal, right? Yeah, I'm condoning witch hunts, aren't I? Thank you, Nirnam. Am I vegan? No, I'm vegetarian, though. I don't know English, could you please repeat everything in Russian? Sure. Ribo. Should do a presentation on how serious ocean overfishing is. Can I tell you something? I started that. One of my first ever presentations, like, right after I did, like, the sharks aren't dangerous thing, opened up a presentation, I set up the title slide, like, the dangers of overfishing, and then, like, I'd made the first slide, and it was like, overfishing is reducing fish populations. And then I was like, okay, now what's the next slide? It's pretty simple, just stop fucking commercial fishing. I don't know, man. You don't eat fish? No, I do not. Though I'm not morally opposed to farmed fish, that I like know the farm. But at this point, the way the human body works is you lose the digestive enzymes that allow you to digest meat if you don't eat meat for a while. And I haven't eaten meat in like 7 or 8 years. So I, you know, at this point, even if I wanted to, I'd just throw up. My body wouldn't be able to digest it. It's my favorite part of the streams where Zach starts a cult.
Money for fish boy. Enjoy your enzymeless body.
Thanks, Chili. I will enjoy my enzymeless body. To be clear, I still possess enzymes, just not meat digesting enzymes, or at least not a lot of them. But like, I'm not opposed to like if there's like a provenly humane fish farm, I'd be down to eat. But I can't really. I'll just throw up. So I'll have Soph do it for me. Isn't that if you eat a large amount of meat at once, you'd be okay with little bits at a time? Well, at this point, my body is basically incapable of digesting meat. So I would need to figure it out. So basically, you need to go back in very slowly. So I would need to start with like soup, like broth, and then move on to like little pieces, small amounts of meat, and then slowly move up towards more and more before I could actually eat like a fish. Like a full thing. A full meal involving meat would take me like a month to build up to. If I didn't want to, you know, throw up at some point. If you had a pet coelacanth, what would you name it? Spiny. I only buy fish from Walmart. The nice person in blue tells me they're from the ocean. And that's good. Yay. Thanks, Nirnim. We love Walmart. Do you guys remember? They got rid of it because so many people complained. You guys remember Walmart's aquarium fish department? It was probably the most disgusting rundown part of Walmart, which is impressive because Walmart's pretty disgusting as it stands. But it was bad. Like, 2-gallon tanks with, like, full-grown Oscars in it, just like disgusting water, and then there'd be a person there with like a fish expert sign, and they would like point to a goldfish and be like, yeah, so that's a guppy. So bad. They got rid of them all around me. I actually submitted a complaint at one point, I think, as like a 14-year-old. I submitted a complaint to Walmart, and now they're not around here. Apparently they're still in some other places. But not around here, at least. I like to think I made the change. My one, like, complaint letter that I made to Walmart that some poor, like, minimum wage employee in India probably read. I like to think that I caused that. Activist Zachary shuts down Walmart page. Let's go. Jesus Christ. This dude said hi from Poland, and I wanted to say hi back to him, and I go to read his name. Z-B-Y-S-Z-E-K. Alright, I got this. Zbysik. Where are your vowels? How is there one vowel in that? How is it like 10 letters and there's one vowel? Where'd they go? Who stole your vowels, bro? Zbysik. I was close? Zbysik. The crazy part is I speak Russian, but Polish is a whole different beast, bro. Russian at least has vowels most of the time. The most you'll go is like 4 letters in Russian without a vowel. Polish, they just do not give a shit. Oh my god, that dude has a Polish name too. Sylwek Darsel. What's up, King Irk? I from Romania. Hello! Zach, it's called Polish language. Yeah, I know. Volleyball position, libero. Brazil? Dope. Hi from your window. Imagine Marge is just there. Flex, you're not in India. Don't say hi from India when you're not in India. You're just Indian. You're in the United States. You're actually like 2 miles away from me right now. Okay, now everyone's doing the hi from joke. Guys, Thursday. You guys know what we're doing Thursday? Thursday, I'm doing a fish drawing from memory competition versus Shark Bites. So Shark Bites and I, we have a judge who is Elbow 2, is going to come in, give us a random fish, and both Shark Bites and I are going to draw them from memory, put them on screen, and you guys will vote who did the better drawing. Should be interesting. I am really bad at shark anatomy, so if there's a shark, I'm probably not going to do a great job. I'm also just bad at drawing in general. And he's really bad at regular fish anatomy, but he'll crush sharks. So it should be interesting. And I told Elbow to give us like varying degrees of difficulty. So start with something easy, you know, like goldfish. And then by the end, you're at like fucking, you know, pineapple grass or something like that. But neither of us know what it looks like. Oh yeah, it's gonna be so fun. I'm excited for it. Tune in Thursday. Is Elbow 2 Elbow however or Elbow hence? That's a great question. I think it's Elboo right now. I think he changed it to Elboo. Yeah, we have 2 Elbows. We have Elbow, who is like Asian guy from fucking Illinois or whatever, who plays Jigglypuff in Melee. And then Elbow 2, who is a hockey player from somewhere. Oh yeah, and chess, that's Elbow 1. Is coelacanth nowadays the exact same species as the one they found fossils of, or the fossil coelacanth have evolved into modern ones? It's not the same as the fossil. I don't know if they evolved into it, or if it's just different species from the same like genus, you know, or family, and just, you know, some of them are extinct and then there's 2 living, you know. It's too short. I don't think they evolved into the other ones. I think the ones that are alive now are just close relatives of the ones that were alive, and those other ones happen to go extinct. Does Zach feel pain? No, I don't. Elbow plays a fascist puff. True. Zach's a fish? Damn it, Flex. Did you not just listen to the entire presentation, bro? Did you learn anything? I saw you writing peep OGs. I learned nothing. Cool. Answer my question. What's your question, Theo? What are those scratches on your fingers? I fixed the house pawn the other day, and it's like built up with a bunch of slated rocks, and they are sharp. No near him. That did not happen. I could almost feel the knuckle fracture. I only hit it with the back of my wrist. I curved. You guys couldn't see, but I like curved my hand in. Hit wall again? No. Does Zach feel love? Only for Soph. Lesson of the day. Don't punch rocks. That's a good lesson. Shall we react to videos? I'm feeling very lazy. Hi. Hi, Black Suit. It says you say you're new here, but you're subbed, and you've been subbed for a month. You're not that new. Zach, do your push-ups? No. React to Chills again? I don't have a Chills video lined up today. I'll show you what I have lined up today. Today we have 13 mythical sea creatures, the shark scarier than the Megalodon from the Mariana Trench. We'll watch Hassan watch that 5 mysterious and unexplained, which is like one of the first videos I ever reacted to. But watch Hassan react to it because I thought that'd be funny as hell. And Strangest Things on Google Earth. Alright. 13 mythical sea creatures.
There are many dangerous sea monsters whose existence has not been proven. Sailors' historical accounts show gigantic creatures swallowing whole ships that are hostile to all humans in the water. Here are 12 of these mythical creatures that many sailors or regular people believed in which some people believe in even today. Umibozu. According to Japanese folklore, Umibozu are said to
Isn't this the one that they showed that like video from the mermaid movie? And I'm so scared. The one that showed the video from the mermaid movie and it's like the dude, there's so many freaking names for this thing. Just like the dude in black, like a fish man thing.
Live in the ocean and capsize the ship of any sailor who dares to
Jesus,
talk to them.
Jesus, that's a ship? Wait, I'm in the way. That's a ship. This. Thing's fucking like, the thing from Moana.
They have a cloud-like gray torso and snake-like limbs. The name of this spirit consists of the kanji Umi, the Japanese character for sea, and Bozu, the sign for Buddhist monk. Probably because this creature is said to have a big, round head similar
It's called the sea monk, the sea Buddhist monk, because it had a round head. Nice.
To the shaved head of a Buddhist monk. In some cases, Umibozu are also described as the mighty yokai, which are various monsters and demons from Japanese myths that have animal
God
or human
damn.
Features and supernatural powers. They're supposed to appear to shipwrecked people in
face. Why is she making that face, bro? You gonna die.
Fishermen. Originally, the Umibozu were drowned priests, which is why they appear with a shaved
God
head
damn.
And seem to be praying. Jormungandr.
Okay.
Jormungandr, the Midgard serpent. Many of you know it from God of War. It is one of the greatest mythical creatures. It lives in the ocean and stretches all over the world. It encounters Thor several times in the Nordic tales. One time when the god rows out with the giant Hymir to fish and he somehow manages to get the snake on the hook. And another time when the giant king Utgard Loki camouflages the snake as a cat and Thor is supposed to lift it as a test, but fails. The snake was created by Loki and the giantess Angerboda, and it is so powerful that it spans the earth, then bites itself in the tail and thus forms the shape of a closed circle.
It spans the entire earth. So it's a snake. So when people believe in like the flat earth, this is what they're talking about, like the ice wall that surrounds the whole earth. Have flat earthers thought about the fact that the ice wall that surrounds the outside of the earth might just be this thing?
As soon as it lets go of its tail, Ragnarok, the downfall of the gods in Norse mythology, begins. This is when the god Thor
So it's permanently it's permanently biting its tail. And if it ever lets go, the downfall of the earth begins.
The serpent for the third time and manages to kill it, but soon after, he dies of its poison himself.
Rip Thor.
Kappa. Kappa.
What?
Elf. Kappa.
Why is it looking at me like this is like live action Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle.
Kappa are one of the most famous creatures from the Japanese folk beliefs. They are yokai that have traits of humans and reptiles and a beak-like mouth. The water deep.
Marge, go ahead and save this image as our thumbnail. What the fuck is this?
Demons attack humans and animals passing their territory, drown them, and then steal their liver. They are only as tall as
children. Steal the liver?
Passing their territory, drown them, and then steal their liver.
Why the liver? Why is this a turtle man who steals your liver? This is like a joke Nat would make up.
They are only as tall as children and relatively harmless on land, but in
the height of children, half turtle, half man, and only exist to steal your liver. I love this. I can't believe I've never heard of this. Is this where Koopa comes from?
Water, they are all the more dangerous. As long as there is a special magical fluid in their Sara, that's the plate-shaped hollow on their head, these beings cannot be defeated by humans. However, if they lose some of the fluid, they become weaker and may even die. Kappa often steals cucumbers or drowns people who ate cucumbers before swimming.
That's some crazy-ass shit to make up. Don't eat your it's like we have the don't eat 30 minutes before swimming. Don't eat cucumbers before swimming or the Kappa will drown you and take your liver.
Still, the little...
Imagine building this statue. Why'd you give him a bowl cut? What a crazy statue to build.
Creatures are not always evil. Sometimes they even help people and heal illnesses or challenge someone to wrestle.
What? Skyla.
This sea monster comes from Greek mythology and consists of the upper body of a young woman and a lower body of six dogs. Skyla has not always been a monster, though.
Okay, that's
originally,
not a, that's
she was
a
the
woman.
Daughter
what
of a nymph
is this
and
clickbait?
Beautiful. But a jealous sorceress poisoned the waters where Skyla liked to go. After taking a bath there, six dog heads and 12 dog
feet
grew
out of her abdomen. There's a full-on nipple out there. How is this YouTube video monetized? There was a full-on nipple in that image. Marge.
Completely disfigured, Skyla wanted to avenge the disaster she had suffered.
I'm not going back.
And became a wild monster. From then on, she lived opposite another monster on a rock in a strait and ate everything that lived and came within her reach. For example, six companions of the Greek hero Odysseus.
Yeah, this video is probably monetized. My other video got demonetized for using a derogatory slur, and the derogatory slur that I used was creamy when I was laughing about the color creamy. But this person just showed a nip, and they're fine.
Charybdis is the monster that lives across the strait from Skyla.
Bro, this is just the Alaskan bullworm from SpongeBob.
Below a rock with a fig tree on it. Three times a day, it draws in the seawater, and thus creates a suction that can devour ships. Soon after, it spits the water back out. The ships that are sucked in can't even be saved by Poseidon. Exactly what the monster Charybdis looks like is not known, but it is said that it is actually the daughter of Poseidon, the god of the sea, and Gaia, the earth. She was so voracious that she stole Hercules' cattle and was therefore exiled to the sea by Zeus.
Damn, how did Poseidon and Gaia make whatever the fuck this is?
Leviathan. The sea monster Leviathan has the combined features
Leviathan.
Of a crocodile, a dragon, a Ooh. Snake, and a whale.
I know it's
the
not technically
is
wrong,
the largest
but goddamn.
And most terrible sea monster ever. According to the Bible, the Leviathan was created by God to play with, since God can cope with evil without a problem. Since any human effort would be wasted on such a monster.
This is the man y'all worship? He created a giant sea monster filled with evil to have some fun?
It is up to God himself to defeat the Leviathan at any time. After the Battle of Armageddon, there is a fight between the Leviathan and the Behemoth, which is the land-dwelling counterpart of the sea monster. The fight is interrupted by God, who kills both monsters with his mighty sword. Iku Turso. Iku Turso is a malicious sea monster from Finnish mythology. What exactly this monster looks like remains unclear,
deer,
but it has different
wolf,
names
sea
that are
monster?
Pretty descriptive. The one who lives on the brink, the bearded one, the ox of death, the one with a thousand heads, the one with a thousand horns. The monster is from Pohjola, a place that is the source of evil according to Finnish mythology. This is pretty fitting as Iku Turso is described as the father of
Why
diseases.
Why are they always so big?
Hydra.
Things huge.
The Hydra is a serpent with 9 heads and the sister of Cerberus, the Chimera, and the Sphinx, all of which are some of the most famous monsters in Greek mythology.
True.
The special thing about the Hydra is that for every head you cut off, 2 new ones grow in the same place. The water snake is therefore incredibly hard to defeat, because with every injury, it only gets stronger, and the head in the middle is even said to be immortal. The Hydra lived in the swamps of Lerna in southern Greece, where it occasionally went to the countryside to prey on herds and devastate fields. At least until
like from Hercules. Good job, chat. Hercules is based on Greek mythology, and this is from Greek mythology. Good job.
Hydra was finally killed by Hercules, who found a way to prevent the regrowth of its heads and buried the immortal head under a rock.
Bye, Chili.
The Kraken.
Sure.
Stories of giant squids attacking and dragging ships into the depths of the ocean have been around for centuries and can be found in many mythologies and cultures around the world. A possible reason for this might be that there are really big cephalopods like the colossal squid, which was probably the real-life prototype of the mystic Kraken.
The
in Norse
prototype.
Mythology, the Kraken appeared in the 12th century. It is said to
be how the narrative is God is just creating crazy shit to just fuck up the oceans for no good reason.
To 2.5 kilometers long and to look like a
floating
island.
I love that
island.
For him.
Due to its enormous size, it can even cause vortexes to form that can sink ships. In the 18th...
Oops, I made a Kraken. Whoopsies, my bad.
In the century, however, the Kraken was mentioned in a scientific paper where it was called Microcosmus Marinus. However, the monster was later dismissed as a mythological creature and removed from the book.
It has a Latin name in a scientific publication. Oh, I love it.
Devil Whale.
Okay.
The Devil Whale is a demonic whale monster that looks like an island when it sleeps. This helps the monster attract unsuspecting sailors who anchor their ships there. As soon as they leave the ship and make a fire on the island, the whale awakens, attacks the ship, and drags it to the bottom of the sea. Brendan the Traveler, an Irish saint, allegedly set foot on the fake island on Easter. After the monks had lit a fire to cook food, the islands...
That looks like an island to you. You looked at that and went, this is a good place to set camp. Totally not a monster. Definitely an island. Yeah, no, I don't see how they could ever tell the difference.
Suddenly began to move, and the sailors hurried back to their ships. In some legends, the monster is not a whale, but a giant turtle. Sirain Croin. Sirain Croin was a giant monster in the Scottish mythology. According to the stories, the creature is so huge that it has to eat up to 7 whales to be satisfied. It's not a stupid monster at all, though. Sirain Croin actually likes to play with its prey. In one story, the giant creature shrinks to the size of a small silverfish that gets caught by a fisherman, only to switch back to its giant monster form and eat the poor guy.
Yakushka. How would that work? The dude just catches a silverfish, brings it back on land, and then it just goes, oh, actually, I'm a fucking skyscraper-sized monster now. Just to eat one human when you need 7 whales a day?
This water horse also stems from the Scottish folk beliefs. It's not a simple monster, but actually a fairy creature.
Oh, wow. He is thick.
A fairy creature. It inhabits the lakes and coastal waters of Scotland and is considered highly dangerous. Yakushka appears in the shape of a beautiful horse and waits for
like
people
that?
Who are attracted by its magnificent figure. But when someone tries to mount it, the person immediately gets trapped because the back of the evil creature secretes a sticky substance which the victim will stick to.
It's a sticky horse. But then how does he eat it? Horses can't get their head to their back. So then now you've just got a person stuck to your back. You just fucking...
With a human still on its back, the creature then gallops towards the sea or the nearest lake and swims to the deepest spot where it drowns the rider and almost completely devours him.
Interesting.
It only leaves the liver, so when the organ is washed ashore, everyone knows that Hakushka has taken a human life once again.
It eats everything except for the liver. And then you've got the Kappa, which only take the liver. So this guy and the Kappa should be a team to fully use the human.
Cthulhu. Cthulhu is probably the most powerful creature on this list. It came to Earth several million years ago and is held captive by a curse in the sunken city of Rulia in a death-like sleep. The body of this being is slightly human-like, but extremely bloated. The head resembles that of a squid, and the face is a tangle of tentacles. It also has long, narrow wings on its back. Cthulhu is one of the great ancients, who are-
Why is every monster so evil? Why aren't there, like, why don't we have, like, Godzilla narrative type shit? Where there's, like, giant mythological monsters that are just here to help out. You know, they're just chilling. Why has everything got to be so evil and just, like, want destruction?
The powerful, extraterrestrial beings that embody the forces of chaos and are probably comparable to gods. Most of them are particularly powerful and cruel representatives of their respective species and worshipped by different people. If the stars align, Cthulhu will be resurrected once again to exercise its reign of terror over the Earth, ultimately leading to the death of all life. Although Cthulhu was actually made up by the writer of a short story, there are still people who believe in its existence and adore this being. Anyway, that was our list of some of the creepiest sea monsters.
Which it was made up for a short story and still people believe it nowadays. Yep, sounds about right. Alright, shark scarier than Meg from Mariana Trench. We got the buzzwords. We got shark, scary, megalodon, and Mariana Trench. This is the ultimate react video.
In March 2013,
started
in the
province
of Shandong, the skeleton of an incredible creature was found. At first, it was considered to be the remains of an ordinary shark that had its fins bitten off. But an examination revealed that such a skeleton of 3.5 meters long, a huge skull, and the structure of the jaw could only belong to a prehistoric grilled shark. This fish existed 80 million years ago and inhabited the planet along with titanosaurs and pterodactyls.
Only okay, not an accurate size comparison. To be clear, titanosaurs are like the size of a mountain. Frilled sharks are like 10 feet long at max. This is not an accurate size comparison.
Dactyls. Only the frilled shark managed to survive to the present day and practically hasn't changed at all. Is it possible?
Why is the pterodactyl so cartoony? Because that's the only stock image that they could get of a pterodactyl for free, I guess.
Only the frilled shark managed to survive to the present day and practically hasn't changed at all. Is it possible to meet one in our time? And would it really be possible to survive after such a meeting? Now we're going to find out.
Would it be possible to survive a meeting with a frilled shark? Yes. They're not scary at all. Not even remotely. They're deep, deep water.
Fast forward to 80 million years ago in the Mesozoic era, when the owner of this giant skeleton floated freely on the ocean.
You could boop him.
Meeting one probably would have meant certain death. After all, the main weapon of the frilled shark is its deadly jaws. 25 rows of teeth. Each row has 3 2-
He's trying so hard to make it sound scary. Dude, he's got like toothbrush teeth. And he's small. And he's deep water, and he's kind of cute. He's like, how many rows of teeth with sharp and like measurements to make it sound more scary? If you think this is scarier than the megalodon, I don't know what to tell you.
2 meter long teeth. The teeth are shaped like a 5-pointed comb-shaped hook, slightly resembling a crown.
Oh, I hope the underwater toothbrush doesn't find me.
They're ranged in an uncharacteristic sequence for sharks, small in the front and enlarged in the depths of the mouth. In total, there are about 300 sharp daggers in its jaw, allowing the frilled shark to confidently catch its victim, starting on...
Why is it undulating? Why is it undulating like that? And why did it catch a black and white...
Equal battle. By the way, it's not completely necessary for it to make a leap for its prey. In the
Dude, the fish just swam into its mouth. That's too easy.
Arsenal of the frilled shark, there are 6 gill slits that create negative pressure. Simply put, you would be sucked into its mouth, no matter how you floundered about and tried to escape. The jaws of the frilled shark are built in such a way that the teeth grow not like they do in humans, perpendicular to the jaw, but inside the mouth. This is what makes
it. Why is the music so intense?
Death trap. Imagine that the frilled shark has grabbed you by the arm. There's only one way out, to push your hand further and hope that your movement coincides with the moment the shark opens its mouth. If you want to pull your limb back, all the skin and part of the muscle will remain on the teeth, sharp as a blade pointing inward. It turns out that if it grabbed you by the hand, you would either have to be left without a hand or completely climb inside the creature, and from there you'd decide what to do next.
You cannot fit in your entire body in a frilled shark. Yeah, or just take your other hand and go, no, bad. It's not that difficult. Can I, like, hold on. I'm unclear on how big frilled sharks are. Yeah, you're not fitting your entire body inside a frilled shark. Cool.
Tommy Lee Jones had such a similar experience what? In the movie Men in Black. I remember that afterwards, he wanted his memory erased. So even if you managed to escape without turning into slowly disintegrating food, you wouldn't be able to forget any of it.
So your two options, just so you guys know, this is what this video is teaching. If you're ever bit by a frilled shark, your two options are to lose your hand or climb inside it and cut your way out like Tommy Lee Jones.
All that would remain would be to write a book called I Was Inside a Frilled Shark and Survived.
What is going on in this video? What is this tangent he's going on? You can either lose your hand or you can climb inside it, cut your way out, want your memory erased, and then write a book about it. You know why? This video is 8 minutes and 30 seconds long. And you need to be 8 minutes long to get double monetized on YouTube. So if you ever see a video that's barely above 8 minutes, it usually means they threw in some filler so that they got the two ads, the monetization. I always make sure my videos are over 8 minutes, but I usually don't try to filler. You just like do more interesting things and talk about more stuff. He's just like doing the life history. If you chose not to pull your arm out, this is what would happen.
Therefore, to escape this killing machine, your only hope would be that there was a bigger predator swimming nearby which would stand up for you.
That's not your only hope. Also, if you are in an environment where you are alive and a frilled shark is alive, you are already dead. You are in the deep sea and you're just pressure.
Would be no other options. Sorry. Fortunately, there were plenty of large marine predators in the Mesozoic era. Mosasaurs, a whole family of giant sea lizards.
What is going on? Is he saying that if a frilled shark bites me, my only options are to lose my hand, climb inside it, cut my way out, write a book about it, or to get rescued by a mosasaur? I'm so confused as to the direction of this video.
18 meters, one and a half of which was the skull, and inside its mouth was definitely no marshmallow. In the prehistoric ocean, this largest lizard could easily devour anything.
Why are we talking about the mosasaur?
But then it probably would have eaten you too for dessert.
Sure.
But let's go back to our time and find out what happens if we come face to face with a modern frilled shark.
You
die. It doesn't wear wireless. If we come face to face with a modern frilled shark.
Okay. I don't feel like this was necessary, and I feel like the fact that they paid for this blender render. The modern frilled shark got drip. I feel like the fact that they paid for this might have been a little bit of a waste, but.
It doesn't wear wireless headphones or a smartphone. Of its gadgets, it's.
Why would you need to know that? Why did you need to specify that the frilled shark doesn't have headphones or a smartphone? Is there anyone in the world who thought that the frilled shark would be wearing headphones and have an iPhone.
Still has the same 25 rows of teeth pointing inward in its mouth, but the size of its torso and jaw have been reduced by half. It feeds on squid, so it probably won't be interested in you. The International Union for Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources has given this species the status of least concern. This was confirmed by people near Tokyo, who managed to capture a frilled shark on video for the first time. It happened in the year 2007, when one such creature rose to the surface. Scientists claimed that it was quite old. In relation to the people, it didn't show any action and swam between them as if it didn't even notice them. However, you can't be certain of their harmlessness just because there haven't been any cases of an attack by a frilled shark on a person. After all, on a Discovery Channel episode about the frilled...
Never been an attack on a human by a frilled shark because they live in the deep ocean where humans would become human soup. Deep ocean treats your body like a blender.
Shark, scientists managed to catch a very young one. When they put it in an aquarium and tried to touch it, it quite confidently jerked towards their hand, trying to protect itself. And it was just a small fish. Double its size, and with it, its self-confidence and desire to protect its territory and offspring.
Why are we talking about the self-confidence of the modern frilled shark? What is this video doing to me?
Now, are you ready to have a heart-to-heart talk with it? It may not eat people, but you could hardly safely jump into the water to such a toothy creature. Let's be honest, humanity doesn't know much about the frilled shark. We haven't come across this creature very often because it lives at extreme depths.
Yep.
You would have to go down 1,500 meters yep. underwater, where the problems are much greater and make the frilled shark seem quite innocent. Next to this, there's a much more dangerous monster, the Kraken. For many centuries, humanity...
What is the shark scarier than Megalodon from Mariana Trench? Not even the Mariana Trench. And how did we get to the Kraken? What is going on? He told me to climb inside a frilled shark, cut my way out, erase my memory, and then write a book about it. And I thought that would be the weirdest development.
He considered this monster a myth. But today, scientists are already actively studying the varieties of giant squid and considering the possibility that in the past, these monsters could really sink ships, like in the Pirates of the Caribbean.
No one's considering
Imagine
that.
But at least one
colossal squid has no reason.
Centimeter black eye of this monster was looking into your eyes. It's an awkward feeling, isn't it? And if it wanted to take revenge on you for
what?
All the calamari
Why?
That humanity is eaten with beer, the fun would end in a matter of seconds. The size of a giant squid can reach 17 meters. This is the height of a five-story house. In the center of this monster is a chitinous beak that can bite through a steel cable 8 centimeters thick. One of these relatively small nightmares was captured on camera in the year 2013. The person who wasn't afraid to swim up so close to the squid and take pictures of it delights in his nerves of steel. Unlike the harmless frilled shark, this creature is extremely dangerous for...
No! Okay, why are you talking about the shark scarier than Megalodon from Mariana Trench? Spend half the video talking about the frilled shark, then say it's harmless, and start talking about the fucking Kraken. Why?
People. In 1946, the Norwegian tanker Brunswick was attacked by a Kraken.
No, it wasn't.
From the ship's captain indicates that the squid was more than 20 meters long and swam at a speed of about 40 kilometers per hour and suddenly attacked the ship. Strong blows weren't able to penetrate the steel skin of the ship, and after a while, the squid swam away. However, this is a ship. If you were swimming in a normal scuba suit, it's unlikely it would protect you. We've studied only 5% of our planet's ocean.
God damn it.
Until recently, the sea serpent and the kraken were considered fictional myths.
That's not
but today,
true.
We know for sure that they are real creatures.
The kraken
but
is not.
Don't go and cancel your vacation after this video. To be sure you're not exposed to any sea monsters, don't swim beyond the buoys. And.
I have. So much. Just what? This is like the, this is like if you asked an AI to produce a video, this is what you would get. You tell an AI, I need you to make a video that's 8 minutes long so I get the best monetization. The topic is frilled shark. And it's just like, it would talk a little bit about like the frilled shark. And then it would just like randomly some outcropping, some like random branch offs and off topic things. And then suddenly it would talk about fucking Kraken out of nowhere. It literally sounds like this video was had no human involved in making it. It was all done automatically, which if so is a hilarious experiment. Anyway, shall we watch Hassan? Hassan's a Turkish politics guy, very big streamer. A lot of people like him. And apparently he watched the 5 Most Mysterious Unexplained Sea Creatures, which we've already watched. But I think it'd be interesting because he has absolutely no idea. Like, he knows nothing about the ocean or science in general. He's a politics guy. So, like, this guy that a lot of people look up to is the super intelligent, well-spoken guy. Let's see if he believes the 5 Unexplained Sea Creatures, which I...
There's no sign that the ocean is the most fascinating place on our planet.
Lovecraft was literally afraid of human-fish hybrids? Yeah.
Space are the two things we are surrounded by, yet know so little about. Every time an explorer plunges into the ocean, it's unlikely that they will come back up to the surface without discovering a new species or variety of creature. But every now and then, an unknown creature is washed up on a beach, or something is spotted during an expedition that cannot be explained. These things, once again, show us the endless possibilities the ocean is home to.
Yeah, fuck that.
Sit back and know that everything talked about in this video is sharing the planet with you. Shark eaten by unknown sea creature.
Is he even watching it?
In 2003, Australian filmmaker Dave Riggs and his crew were asked to tag an adult great white shark along with the alpha had been devoured by another living creature and was deep inside its belly during the recordings. The tag seemed to
this is not a react
within the predator's belly for a further 8 days before finally being excreted and washed up on the beach. So what could possibly eat a 9 foot long healthy great white shark? Well, there have been many theories ranging from an orca or a giant unknown sea creature. Astonishingly, it took 11 years before a plausible theory was released. Dave Rigg himself theorized the only explanation could be that another, even larger, cannibal great white shark was responsible.
Not the only explanation. I don't even. Does he even listening? Does he even have the headphones on? Tons,
making it one of the largest great whites ever recorded. The only other explanation.
Yeah, motherfuckers want to go in the water when that's there, dude. No thanks. Okay? Straight up, no thank you, dude. Okay? I do not understand. Why the fuck you would ever go in the water when there's like a 0.0000001% chance that that's in the water with you?
There's not that chance. There's not. It was like eaten by an orca, right? So it's like an animal that has never once harmed a human outside of captivity where, you know, they're kept in very small cages in horrifying conditions. And, I don't blame them for lashing out. In the wild, an orca has never hurt a person. So...
It is in the water with you. It's just... It might be very far away. Okay?
That was brought
but still...
Up is that the tracker fell off Alpha and was eaten by another fish. So what do you think happened? Did the tracker simply fall off and
was eaten
by a smaller fish that thought it was bait? Or was Alpha pulled deep down in the ocean and eaten by an enormous undiscovered predator?
I don't like this, okay? I don't like the megalodon
furry
shit.
Creature washes up on beach. In early 2015, a mysterious...
Bro, what's happening? Why is it always baffling Russian scientists?
Mysterious carcass of a creature was found washed up...
Because Americans know nothing about Russia and just use it as a scapegoat for everything. So whenever you're going to make something up, you just say it's from Russia and people are like, oh yeah, I don't know anything about that place. That's mysterious. Makes sense.
An island called Sakhalin, which is located along the east coast of Russia. The carcass was ripped apart, covered in blood, had bones protruding from its body, and was unusual in the fact that it had a long beak and was around 11 feet in length. At first it was identified by experts to be some kind of rare big dolphin species, but people argue that due to its fur and large size, this is an unlikely candidate. Not fur. So what exactly was it? Well, despite a few theories, there hasn't been any real explanation. It's unsure if DNA samples were taken, and if they were, nothing has been released. How it ended up on the beach in the first place is also a mystery, since the water around that area is colder than most fish this size would usually live in. This led researchers to think whatever it was may have been brought in by a warm current and died when the waters cooled. Not long after its discovery, another study was done by a group of scientists who came to the conclusion that the carcass could have been a whale cub, possibly that of a beaked whale. Since most whales and dolphins are born with hair that they lose quickly, this would explain the fur, but this would have meant that if it was a beaked whale or dolphin cub, it would have been a very large one. Another theory is that it's just a rare large dolphin and the hair is degraded tissue fibers. But more interestingly, some think that it's an undiscovered sea creature, which with its size and the unexplored areas within the ocean, this, like all the theories mentioned, cannot be ruled out.
It can.
This next mystery.
I love that. I love this, like, given its size and unexplained nature, can't rule out that it's an undiscovered sea monster.
Is actually another washed up creature. Now, I was going to include this thing, which is called the Montauk Monster, that was found washed ashore a beach in New York in 2008. But after reading a lot about it, although it hasn't been fully identified, it doesn't seem like it came from the ocean. Whereas this next one I'm going to talk about.
What? What the fuck? Hey, this is a fun time to mention that Montauk is the original area where Stranger Things was written. And it's written in, like, it's the guy who's from Montauk wrote the original screenplay for Stranger Things that was stolen from that guy. And also, Montauk has a military base where, like, they were doing some experimental shit there.
Also, yeah, it doesn't even look remotely fake at all.
So... why did he just add this in here, dude? It was a raccoon? This is not a raccoon, dude. Yo, Haas, this video is fake bullshit. There are proven biological explanations and this are common animals.
But after reading...
Someone just told him it's like fake bullshit. There are proven explanations and he just read it and then did not react at all. He didn't even say okay. He didn't say no. He just read the message and then just restarted playing the video again. The fuck is that about?
A lot about it. Although it hasn't been fully identified, it doesn't seem like it came from the ocean.
That's so funny.
The next one I'm going to talk about most certainly isn't land-based. There isn't a whole lot of information on this, but it was found by a group of people in 2013 on New Zealand's Bay of Plenty beach. This area is known for having sea creature carcasses washed up, but this one caused a little more mystery, as it was unlike anything previously seen.
It was confirmed by a paleozoologist to be a raccoon. Wait, really? That's what fucking raccoons look like? Fuck that shit, dude.
Its body was 30 feet long and was mostly buried under the sand, but its head and a large dorsal fin could be seen.
This is the orca, right?
Marine biologist to think that
just like you can tell very easily by the teeth that it's an orca.
But this couldn't be 100% confirmed because of its badly decomposed body. Some say that since the jawline, even after decomposition, is so narrow though, that it's definitely not an orca, but it could be an unknown species of whale or an undiscovered creature.
Why does he keep leaving?
Look similar to that.
Is this what Hassan streams are like? I've never watched a Hassan stream. He's talked twice the entire time and just keeps walking away. Why would you ever watch this?
Something.
This is just, you know how I talk about not stealing content, you know, adding your own thing to it, trying to like add your own information. This is just flat out stealing content. He just doesn't care because he has a wide enough audience. That's hilarious.
And something that sounds pretty big. The sound has been tracked every year by scientists since it was first discovered.
Aw, the poor lonely whale.
The sound has deepened over the years, as it would with a regular whale.
I missed all the cute stuff. Fuck. I had a situation at the door.
It's even a whale, but it's definitely something, and something that sounds pretty big. The sound has been tracked every year by scientists since it was first discovered, and incredibly, the tone of the sound has deepened over the years, as it would with-
Dude, I don't wanna hear underwater sounds. That stuff scares the fuck out of me, dude. Underwater sounds are so terrifying. Okay? I don't like any of this. I really don't like all of this, because- it's just so terrifying, dude. I don't know. It, like, you don't know, you don't see it. it can fucking eat you. Like, it's nope. Not cool.
Okay, whales are not eating you. One. I mean, I guess you're valid in being afraid of underwater sounds, but like, I don't know why in particular underwater sounds are scary. I really do not understand Hassan.
He'll call. Take a listen.
He genuinely just does not care. Yeah, he literally just has thalassophobia.
Wait, so normally you couldn't even hear it because it's so slow? Like, I don't understand.
The pitch, bro.
My man says speeded, dude. This entire video is disqualified. It can't eat you, refuse to go in the ocean? Yeah, no shit. That's literally the point, dude.
Is Hassan actually not going in the ocean? That's so funny. Giant Turkish guy with all these like confident opinions and he's afraid of going in the ocean. Probably because of bullshit like this. I bet there's a lot of people who are like raised and like now don't go in the ocean or are afraid of the ocean because of stupid shit like this. Yeah, I don't know why people watch this.
Straight up the fucking point. That is why I don't go in the ocean. So the blue whale can't eat me, okay?
What? Okay, Hassan, thanks for sharing, I guess. Thank God the blue whales won't eat you if you don't go in the ocean. You got a valid point there, my dude.
Okay. And here you are making fun of me, saying that I'm crazy for not going in the ocean, but...
You are crazy. You are absolutely crazy. The blue whale is not capable... It doesn't even make... It makes no sense, and it's so dumb. It's just because something's big does not equal scary and dangerous.
Guess what? I'm not going to be eaten by a fucking blue whale.
You're right, you're not, and nobody is, ever, because blue whales don't eat people. So, that's a fear you can rule out.
Despite comprehensive monitoring and searching, nothing has been found, and nobody's sure what is creating the sound. There has been some speculation.
I don't want to be attacked by a bear, so I'm going to live on the ocean. That way they can never get to me. The difference is, you don't fucking know, dude. You can see a bear, okay? And you know where bears are on the land. We have so much more information.
Does he think blue whales are invisible? You can see a bear, you can't see a blue whale. Which is, by the way, somehow now comparable to a bear in danger.
Of the land, than we do of the ocean. We don't know anything about the ocean, okay? We just don't know. There's so much going on down there that we have not uncovered, okay?
Please stop spreading misinformation, Hassan.
Whereas, you know what the regular bear patterns are?
The bear patterns? Yeah, like we don't have extensive studies on whale migration patterns. The... studies and the research published on whale migration patterns has to be hundreds of times as much information as the bear migration. No one gives a shit about how bears move. No one is tracking bears. We know fucking whale migration like the back of our hands.
Chat is mostly irrational fear. We know more about the fucking outer space.
Nope. You can see more
Wait,
of outer space.
True. What?
Definitely don't know more.
Bull sharks are able to swim in fresh water and are responsible for a ton of bites. There are pics all over them in people's front yards during Florida floods and hurricanes. Yeah, well, fuck that. I'm not going to Florida, dude.
He's
Don't
so
be so
upset.
Sensitive. I've lived in Florida my whole life and have only been bit by a shark once, and I'm a surfer. You think that's going to give me comfort? Crazy? Just because you're stupid enough to be bitten by a fucking shark and you're still surfing around doesn't mean I'm trying to do that, dude. If I got bit by a shark once, it's a wrap. I don't even know. I don't even know how I wouldn't want to be around any body of water. You're in Florida, brother. That's why you don't care. You're Florida, man. Motherfucker literally said, I've only been bit by a shark once.
That it's a malformed blue whale or a mix.
I love this chat comment. We got Elon Musk trying to colonize Mars when we know next to nothing about our oceans. Can we stop the narrative of we know next to nothing about our oceans? That's such a stupid narrative. The only thing we know about outer space is based on like physics and then sight. That's it. The ocean we actually have interactions with in lots of ways.
So blue whale.
Rovers can bring back samples.
Whale and another species. If it is the sound of a whale, then just think, it could be the call of an undiscovered species that is the last of its kind left in the world. Unfortunately though, all that we are left with is the sound that this incredible creature makes, easily making it one of the ocean's biggest mysteries. An interesting-
Space is infinite, ocean is finite, we absolutely know more about the ocean. No, they meant space when they meant like mapping out like the moon and Mars and shit like that.
And yeah, but the moon and Mars are not space. Space is like an infinitely expanding universe of fucking stars and planets beyond our wildest comprehension. The ocean is literally right here, and we have frequent interactions with.
Maybe even like astral charts or whatever, like fucking where
astral charts.
Certain stars are in comparison to the ocean.
I love the bullshitting. It's so funny when like big streamers. I mean, I'm guilty of it somewhat myself, but like big streamers who think that they're just like want to be the expert on stuff for their chat. They want to like know what they're talking about, just say stuff. There's a Mario streamer named Liam who has the world record right now in 120 star Mario speedrunning, who just acts like he knows everything. And he does it somewhat ironically, so it's a joke, but there are a lot of streamers who don't do it ironically. They'll just straight up like act like they know what they're talking about and say things in ways that seem like they know what they're saying.
We have not mapped out. We've only mapped out like what 10% of the fucking ocean or some shit. Like, I know.
We've only mapped out 10% of the ocean. Ocean. Depth map. Cool. There's the entire world's oceans mapped out by depth, by temperature. Oh no, this is still depth. We've got salt maps. There's temperature maps. There's current maps. What else would you guys like to see?
You know that... like, our solar system, maybe. Dude, there's just so much shit going on down there that we have not fucking... messed around with. That's why I have tremendous respect for James Cameron, okay? Like, his movies are whatever. I don't really give a fuck. His movies are ass cheeks, but he's a one-trick pony. His movies are all the fucking same, but he literally goes, he goes to the fucking bottom of the ocean on his own. He's just chilling.
I don't even know anything about James Cameron. Much.
Machines can't function underwater.
I mean, machines can't function underwater. Why does he just read things and then resume the video and not respond? Why do you... I would never do that. I would never read someone's comment and then just move on like it never happened. That's such a weird thing to do.
That the search for the 52-hertz whale is being released soon. The documentary was funded by Kickstarter, and Leonardo DiCaprio gave $50,000 to help...
help find the lonely whale with Adrian Grenier and Josh Zaman? Oh my god. Dude, Adrian Grenier, or Grenier, however you say his last name, is the fucking quintessential... He is not the quintessential, sorry. Archetypical Hollywood celeb, dude. He's the greatest.
The campaign hit its target, which it did. The team recently went out in search for the whale, and I believe they are working on a documentary now, which I am super excited to see. Mysterious giant shark. In early 2000, scientists from Japan conducted a study to look.
So we know Pacific sleeper shark, Greenland shark, exaggerated features, you know. We know all of that, but I have a feeling that he is going to assume megalodon.
More about marine life in the Mariana Trench. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with the Mariana Trench, it's thought to be the deepest part of any of the world's oceans and is located in the Western Pacific. Now, its precise depth is hazy, but it's thought the trench is about 6.8 miles deep. At these depths, it's hard to believe anything could survive, but surprisingly, there are many fish and living organisms down there, which I will talk.
That's what I'm saying, dude. This shit is fucked. Like, look at all this shit down there.
It's a fucking comb jelly. It's just a moving plastic bag. This is a Dumbo octopus. This is the cutest thing in the world. Like, come on.
It's just dark as night. You can't see any. It's pitch black down there. You can't see shit. And then there's like fucking little aliens down there. Except for this thing. This thing looks pretty cute. I bet that it's a vicious creature, though. I bet it's like
not
the most poisonous.
Nope, just a Dumbo octopus. It just kind of flaps its ears and then floats.
Got the most poisonous, like, little nub thing. I don't know.
Talk more about in a documentary about the Marianas Trench. Anyway, the Japanese scientist was studying an area not far from the trench called the...
So far from the trench. Not far from the trench. They're talking about Japan. Like, inland Japan.
Finally caught a stream after months. Love the videos and am glad another marine biologist is making fun of these videos. Much love from Florida, homie.
Not a marine biologist, but thank you. This is so, I love, this was my like most favorite thing about this video is that they say like shark here, Mariana Trench down here. And these are like entire island sections of Japan. Like, this is not close at all. The Mariana Trench is only mentioned just as a way to scare people.
Suruga Bay. They had submerged a container with special bait at a depth of around 1 mile in hopes of capturing on camera whatever wanted to feed on it. This is a common way of videoing and identifying new and existing sea creatures. At first, the camera picked up a few small known sea creatures, followed by a shoal of rare deep sea sharks that measured 6 foot long. If this wasn't exciting enough for the researchers, the sharks scattered quickly and a huge creature came into view. Its size cannot be justified on the video footage, but the researchers said it would have been between 30 to 50 feet in length. Just know the Guinness World Record for the largest shark is 37 feet, so if the proportions the researchers have given are correct, this could be the largest shark ever recorded. Take a look.
Oh, look at the chimera.
Is that it?
No, that's the chimera.
Bro, you can't even see, dude. It doesn't... It covers the entire fucking thing. What? Megalodon is bullshit, though, I'm pretty sure. Oh my god, dude. Oh my god, dude.
It's just a fucking Greenland shark.
Oh my god, dude.
Dude, this is just like a probably like a 300-year-old shark who's just chilling, just having a good time. And Hassan's like, oh my god.
Nope. Nope.
Scientists aren't exactly sure.
I mean, if he's scared of blue whales eating him, it makes sense, I guess, that he'd be scared of a Greenland shark.
What type of shark it is, and people have said it could be the long thought to be extinct Megalodon, the gigantic monster of the sea that lived over 2 million years ago and is labeled the largest, most powerful predator.
I was gonna say, people saying Megalodon is bullshit, it was a real fucking creature. There's like fossils of it, no?
Someone, I love how confident Twitch chat is. Someone in Twitch chat was like, it's a basking shark, my dude. Like, basking sharks look anything like that? Nope, not a basking shark. But people in chat are just so confident. They're like, it's a basking shark, my dude. Like, I get your point, but why are you talking so confidently if you have no fucking clue what you're talking about?
Isn't that a Greenland shark? What are you, a fucking shark expert, dude? Why... The Greenland shark can live 200 plus years? What?
what are you, a shark expert, dude?
...in history. But another theory is that the footage caught a very large, very rare Pacific sleeper shark. Sleeper sharks can grow to lengths of 20 feet.
Not very
feet,
rare, by the
so
way.
So even if it was a sleeper, it would have been the biggest and longest of its kind to have ever been
spotted. What's up, GTM?
So that's 5 mysterious sea creatures.
Megalodon is extinct. It is real, but it's extinct, I'm pretty sure.
Oh, come on. You could have just left it. Damn it. I was happy with Hassan for a second. Well, you gave it your best effort, buddy.
Don't forget, this is only a fraction of the creatures that must be out there. There is bound to be thousands of undiscovered species swimming around right now, and there are also many mythical creatures that people think could exist, but I'm saving those for another day.
He don't bite, man, just pet it? Bro, pet what part, dude? It's like that $500 million mansion. You need a fucking go-kart to go from one side to the other.
It's not that
to pet
big.
Both sides of the fucking thing.
I hope even.
Yeah, that's that guy could watch that video and be afraid of a blue whale. That is the man. I mean, I guess everyone has their expertise, right? Like, my expertise is not politics. You wouldn't trust my opinions of politics, but you can trust stuff that I say regarding fish. But like, what is the equivalent of being scared of a blue whale? Like, what is the politics equivalent of that? That's like such a low level of knowledge about like the ocean and such like an innate stupid fear. What is the politics equivalent of that? Is that like being anti-vax? Is Hassan the anti-vax of marine biologists by being scared of blue whales? All right, strangest things found on Google Earth.
Like and subscribe right now, or this spider will crawl on your face while you're sleeping. Thanks to Google.
Always love it. Always love when we start with a threat. It's been a while. I've been missing it, actually. I feel like I haven't been threatened enough as of lately. So I'm glad we're threatening each other again.
Google's incredible repertoire of mapping tools, we've been able to explore the surface of the moon, swim deep in the ocean, or experience bird's eye.
Can you threaten us? No. What do I threaten you with? What do you guys not want to happen? What are you guys looking forward to the least right now? Make sure you sub or you'll have to crawl inside a frilled shark and cut your way out and then write a book about it. Okay, someone said threaten me daddy, so I'm gonna go ahead and
street level views from all over the planet, but some things have been discovered on Google Earth that have totally perplexed people on the internet. From the Sandy Islands to the Crabzilla, here are the
I'm sorry, what?
Sandy Islands to the Crabs.
Look at this! This is literally like the we watched a whole ass Photoshop tutorial on how to make fake Crabzilla images. This is like picture perfect, the exact tutorial that we made. I can literally tell exactly how this image was made. And then why, when it zoomed in this image, is it suddenly clearer? Why is it like dark here, but here it's so clear? Oh, I love it.
Here are the strangest things found on Google Earth.
All right.
Number 10, gigantic alligator.
Cool. So then if that's a real like gigantic alligator, if I like Google alligator, or what is it? You Google crocodile? Is that what it is? Fuck, I can't find it. Justin found it once upon a time. Oh, alligator transparent. Thank you, Whirly. Alligator transparent. Where is it? Whirly, it's gone! Whirly found it? Okay. Send me. Add top down. Okay. Ah, there we go. Alligator transparent top down on Google Images. Interesting. Very interesting. Must be real, though.
A mall in Dubai found an alligator and had him delivered to them from Australia. The alligator is one of the biggest of its species, reaching almost 5 meters in length.
What?
And yes, almost 1,600.
Wait, they're not talking about the photo?
Imagination run wild and see for yourself how big that really is. The alligator is expected to grow consistently for almost.
They're just talking about a real alligator that was transferred from an aquarium. What was that image in the beginning then?
50 years. But that is nothing compared to the alligator shadow, which was found on Google Maps, also in Dubai. The alligator was expected to be as big as a two-story house and was measured to be 10 meters.
Two-story house? He said this is measured to be 10 meters? Homie, these are skyscrapers. And he towers over them. This is not 10 meters. This is a whole ass island. The two-story house is like the tip of his nose. Two-story house is one of these specks on the beach. Yeah, 10 kilometers maybe, 10 miles.
...in length. People have said that this picture was photoshopped, but gigantic alligators have existed years back. Sarcosuchus, Rome...
Okay, Sarcosuchus is not even remotely comparable to something that is the size of an island. Sarcosuchus is just a mildly larger version of modern alligators.
...around the Earth for centuries, millions of years back. They ruled the Earth for a really long time, but that was...
I love how anytime, like, videos like this talk about, like, ancient creatures, like, extinct animals, they always say ruled the Earth. Is there a consensus on who ruled the Earth? Because I feel like it's constantly like, this creature ruled the Earth, and this creature ruled the Earth, and this creature ruled the Earth. Like, they can't all have ruled the Earth. Sarcosuchus was probably just like a normal mid-food chain animal.
45 million years ago. They were so large in size, no one really challenged them. The bones of the alligator have been collected and showcased
Pretty
in
cool.
museums with other ancient creatures. But they were wiped from the face of the Earth after some time. Could this be one of the species? And what if more of them are somehow still inside the oceans? We might find out soon.
Before we move on, I've got a little challenge for you.
Oh, it's one of these, the challenges.
So here's the deal. You just leave a like on this video, smash that subscribe button, and hit the notification bell, and you'll get 25 years of amazing luck. Try it. It really works.
Has this ever worked? It absolutely works. Telling people to subscribe to your videos absolutely makes people subscribe to your videos. I remember I told you guys the one time that I was like telling people to sub to my... I told my people to sub one time, and that video got like five times as many subs as every other video I've ever done. So please sub. But like, yeah, it absolutely makes a difference. So I understand why they do it. It's just cringe as fuck, and that's why I don't do it.
Sandy Island. Next up, we have the most mysterious island in the world. Because our maps were consistently updated with input from explorers and cartographers, it wasn't uncommon for an unknown piece of land to show up on them. While it's an error most of the time, on occasion, maps do contain things we had no idea existed. Take the Sandy Island in the Pacific Ocean, which showed up on some maps, but not on others. In reality, there's nothing there, and has since been removed by Google Maps. It's not entirely an error, though, as the island has been showing up on maps since at least 1876. It was first recorded by a whaling ship called Velocity.
Okay, so it's a shallow land layer. And as the water, the tide rises and falls, it's revealed and non-revealed. Is that the conclusion here? So it's on some maps, but not on others?
And we still have no idea what it is they saw there. The interesting thing is that it's not blurred. It has been completely wiped out from records of Google Maps. Can the government be behind this? We might never know what goes
Why?
On.
Why would the government remove Sandy Island, a tiny island? Also, the government. This is an Australian island. It's a little outcropping right off the coast of Australia. What is the government?
Number 8, giant missile.
Thanks, Sapphire Waffle.
This is one of the weirdest things that's been found on Google Earth. Some users discovered a particularly frightening man-made weapon that was flying over Utah in 2006. This seemingly cruise missile image was taken while sailing freely over the United States. We don't know how the government allowed the missile to fly over civilian areas, but it sure looks real. However, others thought it was a jet, but with dark wings. If folks from Utah are listening, rest assured that it's not hurt anyone. Number 7.
What? How was that on Google Earth? Who found that on Google Earth? That was a video. That was just like an image from the ground. It's not even related to the title whatsoever.
Giant spider.
We've seen this one before. Didn't we watch an entire video like dissecting this Spider-Zilla thing? I think we watched an entire video on this. Rich, go check Guy Nye's Twitter. Trust me.
All of us probably remember getting scared of finding spiders in our rooms. Spiders are not really that dangerous if you think logically, unless you're living in Australia. But you know what's more terrifying than a normal spider? A gigantic spider. On an island in the middle of the ocean, Mexico Greg found an unusual thing in one of the images they obtained of the island from Google Earth. Yes, it was one of a giant spider, which was seen crawling on one of the
movements.
The organization hasn't been able to identify where the creature could have appeared
from. It's so dumb. I love how the video we watched tried to justify it as like a weird shadow thing. It's like, no, it's clearly a spider shape. It's just like, it doesn't fit. It's not like the same quality as the rest of the image. The angling is wrong because you can tell by the light side on that rock that the rock is sloped upwards to the right, but the image is the spider's completely flat. It just looks so fake.
Considering the fact that the place is a lifeless area, but it could be that the spider could have gotten there from inside the ocean. If you think spiders cannot swim, think again. Many spiders are known to swim in water. There are spiders known as the diving bell spider that swim in the ocean. Could it be the descendant of one of these giant spiders which was seen on the island? Let us know your views on it.
They also were not that big.
Loch Ness Monster.
What?
State-of-the-art sonar equipment, a yellow submarine, and even a white witch have all been used to try and find the elusive Loch Ness Monster.
The image that is provably fake by the person who sent it?
The Loch Ness Monster is a creature said to live in Loch Ness in the Highlands of Scotland. A monk was the first person who claimed to have seen Nessie in the 7th century. The first photograph was taken in 1933, but the scientific community has never confirmed the Loch Ness Monster's existence. But it seems
for
all
good
you
reason.
Need to track Nessie down is an iPhone. Mysterious images taken from space are making waves with Nessie fans, as they appear to show a creature swimming in the world's most...
We've seen this one before, right? I don't even remember what to say. I just, like, taking this as evidence that the fucking Loch Ness Monster is hilarious.
Famous Loch. The pictures were captured separately by two amateur hunters, Peter Thane and Andy Dixon, as they used an iPhone satellite map app. It's been feared that the 1,500-year legend was over after 18 months without a recognized sighting. But now, enthusiasts' hopes have been raised once again.
That's what raised their hopes? They went 18 months without a sighting and they were all like, damn, maybe the Loch Ness Monster isn't real. And then someone saw a shadow on Google Maps and they're like, we got him.
Number 5. UFO sighting in Antarctica.
What?
Most countries are now on the map, which provides a broad view of the world. Alien believers also use it, and they believe they've observed the form of alien life. It is believed that a UFO landing site was found in Antarctica. In a screenshot of Google Earth, a huge disc was seen by a user. It could easily be the hiding place of aliens, as Antarctica is still the least discovered part of the world. In another image, you'll see a small depression in the snow.
I have no idea what I'm looking at. I'm genuinely trying and I'm lost.
With no other traces around. An outstanding representative of the Russian UFO community, Valentin Degtyarev, believes that the location is a sign of alien life forms.
An outstanding member of the Russian UFO community says that image is UFO activity.
It is 65 meters wide and 230 meters long, so it's large enough to be used for shipbuilding. What do you guys think? Is it real and are aliens planning to take over the Earth? Number 4. Megalodon.
Let's go.
This picture
fearing.
May provide the whereabouts,
you might not see
or
it.
At least give some surety that the Megalodon shark still exists. The photo was taken in the month of November 2017 from Google Earth. The picture taken shows a shadow.
This is a different picture. He's shown three different pictures.
A shark. Explorers analyzed this picture very carefully and said that this creature could easily be bigger than 70 feet. We know that the Megalodon is believed to be around 60 feet, and this picture from Google Earth could actually be of a random Megalodon floating in the ocean.
Nope.
The scientists have discovered just
3%
of the Earth's waters, so we don't really know what kind of creatures exist in the deepest parts of our oceans.
Well,
this picture
we do,
was taken from
the
Persian
part.
Gulf on the Indian Ocean. It was later sent to experts at the University of Columbia. They couldn't believe what they'd found. Due to the huge size of the creature, they strongly suggest it was a sighting of the Megalodon shark.
No, they did not. This was not sent to researchers at Columbia who then strongly suggested it was a Megalodon. No one at the University of Columbia decided that. I'm so over it.
Shark. What do you guys think?
Believe it or not, you can also find that with the top down thing. Is that true, Whirly? Shark top down transparent. I'd have to see it again. The problem is they're all going to look the same. Oh, is it this? Turned and blurred. No, the tail bends the other way. Point is, it's very easy to make things like this. But yeah, no. The fucking University of Columbia had nothing to do with this. Jesus Christ.
Number 3. Mysterious pyramid.
Okay.
This find from Google Earth shows an anomaly that some believe could be an unknown pyramid. Dozens of anomalies in Egypt have been detected using Google Earth in the past 5 years. However, there is debate as to whether they represent natural features or artificial structures.
You can rotate and flip an image, Zach. Yeah, but the people who make these are so lazy. They're so bad that I just have to imagine they wouldn't go through that effort.
More information about this mysterious pyramid is needed, but the security and economic situation in Egypt has limited the number and size of excavations.
What?
And with that, it's now time.
There's just a pyramid that they haven't excavated yet, and that is the strangest thing found on Google Earth. Alright, well, everybody ready for our best pick?
Time for today's subscriber pick. Today's photo was sent to us by one of our subscribers.
So wow.
Across a photo online and
a very poorly photoshopped
it, just send
Google
it over to us.
Image
Who
of
knows?
A crab.
We might even feature it in a future video. Number 2. This picture seems like it was photoshopped, but we get the idea behind it. What this image is referring to.
Seems like it was photoshopped? Seems? I think it more than seems like. Why is it suddenly crystal clear here, but so blur? Oh my god.
Crabzilla, which we're going to talk about now.
Okay.
A picture that showed a huge 50-foot-long crab made waves on the internet a few years back. While some insist it's proof of Crabzilla, others argue that the shadowy figure is nothing more than a playful hoax.
That one doesn't even make any sense.
The image shows the outline of a crab, dwarfing the fishing boats resting on the nearby pier.
Nice, Soph.
It is shaped like a Japanese crab, which is the largest
species
of crabs.
It is not shaped like a spider crab at all.
12 feet.
It's shaped like a blue crab. How are you going to say this is shaped like a spider crab? It's not even remotely shaped like that.
Posted on a website called Weird Wistable. An online collection of strange and unusual sightings in the town. Its owner, Quentin Winter, said that at first, he thought the image, which was sent to him by a follower, showed an unusual sand formation.
This isn't even the same image. He's just talking about a completely different story. That's the image off the deck in Whitstable. This is a completely different place and image.
It's a monster of the deep. Number 1. Bigfoot.
Okay. Bigfoot on Google Earth.
A video posted on YouTube showed the photos taken from satellite imagery sites that showed a mysterious, dark shape lurking in the forest along the Canadian Highway in British Columbia, Canada.
Cool.
Interestingly, unidentified creatures can only be seen from a certain angle.
Burnt wood! It's just a trunk. I'm gonna give you various other things. Could be a bear. Could be a million things, but my guess is just a trunk, a wood trunk.
The clip was uploaded by supernatural phenomenon researcher Wow For Real and has been viewed more than 7,500 times so far. YouTuber user Kevin Scherf believed in what he saw and wrote, quote, "I told you that there's a Bigfoot. The evidence is..."
Imagine posting this image, this blurry ass, slightly brown outline through some bushes and being like, "I fucking told you that Bigfoot was real. God damn it, I'm right."
Clear as it is today. However, other users say that it's just a tree trunk.
Yeah. That makes sense, because it is. It is just a tree trunk. That fits. I see that. See that relation. Oh, what's up, guys? How you doing? How's your days? Honestly, I think it's just a dude doing drugs in the forest. I think it's more likely just a tree trunk. But there are a million possibilities before you get to fucking Bigfoot. Alright, team. Well, I am going to go shower, eat dinner, go to volleyball. I hope you have an amazing night. I hope you enjoyed stream today. Thursday, 4:30-ish EST, drawing fish from memory contest versus shark bites. Gonna be fucking fire. Show up to that. I will add everyone as I usually do, but mark that shit in the calendar. Versus shark bites. Christian, it's a shark scientist from the UK. So shark scientist from the UK, fish biologist from the United States. Who can draw fish from memory better? Should be interesting. All right. Bye, guys. Have a nice day.